analysis for 24-9-2018. The first news item, TDP MLA leader shot dead by the Maoist in Visakhapatnam. So the place in Haraku where there were two important MLA leaders who have been, the present and also the former MLA leaders, they had been shot dead by the cadres who have been banned CPI. So it's the Maoist people. So this was near a Nivitiput village in Dambriguda Mandal in the agency area of the Visakhapatnam district. So this is one of the incident to what had happened in Haraku. Second, the Maldives strong man faces the defeat. So this is with respect to the Maldives opposition leader, Mr. Ibrahim Mohamed Sohail. So he won the presidential elections against the strong president, Abdullah Yamin. So this was one of the important presidential elections where Mr. Abdullah Yamin lost it and Ibrahim Mohamed has won the presidential polls. And this was with respect to the midnight. By then the 60% is what he was lead with respect to it. And this was a clear victory to what had been received by the Ibrahim and Mohammed Sohail. So there's one important aspect. The next, states told to harm PHCs in fight against the TB. So we have a ambitious target to be looked on to eradicate the TB by 2025. So this is one of the 5 years ahead of the target, which was being fixed by the World Health Organization. So on limelight of it, the Ministry of the Health and Family Welfare, they have directed all the states to expand the TB diagnostic services to all the primary health centers. On respect to it, on this was one of the important aspect where the ministry had written to all the state mission directors on September 19, they had to expand the sputum smear microscopic services. So this has to be throughout the country level by December. And the important to what we have as in microscopic centers, that designated microscopic centers, are more than 14,000, and by now which has been established are at least 25,650 such primary health centers which has been established. So by establishing these centers, they would be able to prevent the sample loss and they will be able to detect the case as well. So they can improve the case detections as well. And this is one of the important aspect to what has been directed to the states to make all the non-DMH and DMC PHCs as designated as PHCs, as primary health centers, either in terms of including even in the urban areas to be as a microscopic centers. And you should know basic information with respect to TB, why we are trying to eradicate the TB by 2025 is that we have an estimated population of nearly 25 lakh TB patients. Out of them, 13 lakh have been captured under the government data. The rest of the people are not being taken under the consideration because of the lack of patients who are not being detected properly. So in 2015, the incidence were 217 people per lakh population, and this has been a burden to India. And in 2017, it's 211. But our target is that we have to get it down to 44 per lakh by 2025. So this is one of the challenge, and the year is what we are trying to eradicate the TB by 2025. On limelight of this is what the steps which has been taken, and they're trying to deploy it as much as PHCs in the country. So this is one of the aspect, but we also have a sideline report, that's a global TB report of 2017, which is estimating India that it has an incidence of TB to be as 28 lakhs. So this is actually the world's quarter of the TB cases which has been registered in India. So this is one of the important report which has been telling that it's not 27, rather it is 28 lakh people who have been under the TB cases. So this is about it. And the next one, Commander Tommy sighted by Navy aircraft. So this with respect to the lost and found. So this commander who has been lost with respect to where his boat, which is the non-motorized boat, was damaged on September 21st. So this was with reasons to the rough weather and also the sea conditions. So what is this incident is all about is because he was on to the circumnavigation with respect to the one of the sailboat where he had participated in the Golden Globe race. So he was the only person who has been invitee, a sailor from Asia, for the prestigious GGR, that's a Golden Globe race. So this race has actually started on Les Labels on France in July. So this incident had taken place on on September 21. He was found, and before that he has been almost sailed 84 days. So this person was with respect to the third position out of 18 international participants, and he sailed almost 10,500 nautical miles. So this was one of the race which was being conducted, and he gives a prestige to the Asia, being as one of the only sailor was been as one of the invitee for the entire GGR. And due to the rough weathers and also the sea conditions, he's been, a particular boat was been damaged, and now he's been found. So there are different deployments which has been happening to rescue the person, and by this day he would be completely rescued out. So this is about it. And you should know basic information with respect to the GGR, where the participants are required to sail around the world in a single handed, and it should be a non-stoppable. So here the boats, they will not have any kind of a boat designs or newer technology, anything newer than 1968 they would not be allowed. And they are not supposed to use the GPS as well, and satellite communication and navigational aids which has been completely dismantled, which means it's been forbidden from using them. But they have to come up with all traditional means of navigation, like they have to locate the stars, and using that they have to come up with the physical maps, and they have to sail with respect to 30,000 mile journey. So this was respected to the seas. So this was one of the important, but they have been welcome to use the satellite phone for any medical emergencies only. So this is one of the important conditions to what has been put forth by the GGR race, and this was being done. But right now the person has been rescued, in sense the whatever the traces he tried to connect with all the gadgets to what he had within the old system of the boat, and the connections was given, and now different deployment is going to rescue the person, Mr. Commander Toby. So this is about it. The basic informations, you have it here, you can just look on to it. And you should know about the person who connected it. It is Sir Robin Knox Johnston of UK. This is to commemorating the 50 years of the world's first solo non-stop circumnavigation, so which was undertaken in 1968. This was on the board of Indian built boat Suhaili. So this is one of the aspects. And the next one, what caused the floods in Kerala? So we here we have the important reasons which actually led to the extreme flood across Kerala. The first is that above the normal seasonal. So we had rainfall above the normal season. Secondly, extreme rainfall events, which is almost across the state during the season. And we had 90% over reservoir storage, which is also one of the reasons. And unprecedented extreme rainfall was also another reason why the catchment areas of the major reservoirs in the state had led to the disasters. So these are the main important four points which has led to the disaster to what had happened in Kerala. So you have the basic information here. The summer monsoon rainfall was almost like 2290 mm, which is 53% above the normal. And this was something where it is during the summer monsoon period, it had recorded 1619 mm, and this makes Kerala to be the third wettest year in the last 118 years. So earlier it was in 2018 to whatever happened here. In 1924 it was one situation, 1961, and in 2018 Kerala is recording to be as a third wettest year. And this is about where it's been about like 3600 mm on the annual rainfall. So this is one of the records on the sidelines of the damage of the Kerala in Britain. And again, you have to know with respect to the coverage till when the rainfall was been witnessed, the extreme rainfall. It was till August 21st. And the Kerala has received 1634.5 mm rainfall. This was in the time period between May 1st to August 7th. So in just in the span of May 1st to August 7th, in 1 month, this is the minimum, this was the range of the rainfall which was being recorded. And this was with respect to the period average rainfall of 1619.3 mm, that was in terms of the monsoon period. This was something more about it. And the 6 of the 7 major reservoirs in the state had almost had a storage 90% before August 8th, and the Kerala was completely filled up with the unprecedented extreme rainfall events in Britain. So this was one of the important aspects, and this was one of the important which was being resulted on the hydrology and the earth system sciences on the discussions to what they bought it as a clearance to what would have made a disaster for Kerala. So this is about it. And the next one, citizen science initiative helps save hornbills. So here we have a latest report which has been coming from the Indian Birds Journal. So in this report they were talking about the work which was done by the volunteers, where they were documenting the hornbills in different parts of the country in the last 3 years. So it's called as a citizen science initiative, which is documenting the Indian hornbills, where it is the conservation of the unique bird. And the hornbill initiative website is www.hornbills.in. This is actually an interactive web interface which allows a person to report on the hornbills anywhere in India. So there's one of the observations which was live on the hornbill. So it might be in terms of call a report or a dead or a hunted or a captive bird. They have to report out onto this particular web interface, which is an interactive and written. So on total, we have 9 hornbill species in India. So this is one of the informations which has been distributed, and this was not very clear to where are they being deployed and what is the areas which has been proliferated. By the help of this documenting Indian hornbills through the initiative called www.hornbill.in website, they were being able to track almost 938 records from 430 contributors, which has been coming from 26 states including the national capital and also the 2 union territories. So this has been very important. And apart from that, the more sites which had been recorded was Karnataka, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, Assam and Arunachal Pradesh. So these were the areas which you can find the hornbills in larger, and 41% of the observations were made within the protected areas and 59% were made outside the protected areas. And few important hornbills which were under the list were endangered hornbills were narcodamp hornbills, and they were restricted to 6 kilometers and they were found in the Andamans. But there are few other hornbills who are into the stage of vulnerable or near threatened species. You can find there are rufous necked hornbill and Houston brown hornbill, great hornbill, which were being observed in several states in the northeastern India. But among the most sightings, Karnataka had the highest number of records. So it was had a significant numbers, and also with respect to Assam and Arunachal Pradesh. So this was a very good record of information and presence from Sikkim and Chhattisgarh as well, where there were no earlier records in these particular areas, but there were good informations being recorded on those things as well. So there were a few important sightings on the Oriental hornbill and also the Indian grey hornbill, where it is in the green spaces within the city's limits like New Delhi and the Chandigarh, which highlighted the presence of these particular hornbills on the tree covers, which has been taken as in habitat. So there's again an important aspect to where it has been found in the urban areas as well, urban tree covers. So these kinds of news are very rare, and it's been evident that you have to make a note of all this information to what is the document all about and what the varieties of hornbills we have, and which is a state which has a long storage and also the reporting habitat areas of the hornbills in Britain. The next one, publishing poll candidates propaganda is paid news. So here we have the repeated publication of the propaganda which has been lauding on the achievements of the candidate in the elections. They're telling that this is nothing but the paid news, and this is one of the petition which was been filed by the Election Commission of India, this before the Supreme Court. So here it's telling that the Supreme Court has to declare whether these kind of an achievements which has been done by the candidate, it's nothing but the paid news. It has to be declared, and the politicians, they cannot take an advantage saying that it's a fundamental right of speech. This can't be when it comes to the motivated propaganda. So this has to be declared, and they want it to be declared as a paid news because it's been circulated on the newspapers and which is being covered in terms of voluminous part. So this case was actually put forth with respect to where the commission has put an appeal against the decision of the Delhi High Court, where the Delhi High Court had said that the disqualification of the MP, BJP leader Mr. Mishra, that it is something where is using the fundamental right of freedom of speech and expression. Because here the filing, though it was the Delhi High Court which withheld the disqualification, the Election Commission had actually filed a disqualification on accounts for money which has been spent on the expenses were not being listed. But here the Delhi High Court came forward and said that it was his right of enjoying the freedom of speech and expression. On limelight of this, this was being brought before the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court in near future will be giving the information on the paid news as well. And here the Election Commission also made it very clear that it is something where it is unholy alliances. And the appeal was significant because the court is being shut his eyes on this particular case, and it is also getting an assertion of the freedom of speech would become a stock pretense, and also it might be a plea for a service provider and also the beneficiary candidate. So this cannot be allowed, and this is one of the petition toward the Election Commission has been filed before the Supreme Court. So this is on the background situation, and this is with respect to it, because there were almost like the five newspapers had published 42 news items which were completely biased, one-sided and aimed furthering the prospects of Mr. Mishra. So this was when the definition to the paid news had come into the picture. They wanted to get it fit and it has to be cleared, and this particular petition's ruling should be coming from the Supreme Court. So this is about it. And the next one, India looks to buy the Israel missiles. So here this is with respect to the deal to procure the Spike anti-tank guided missile from Israel through the government-to-government route. So this is one of the approval to what we have to get it from the Defense Acquisition Council. And before that, the validation trials has to move on, because this is a deal with almost like 170 launches, 4,500 missiles and 15 simulators. Earlierly, the trials, what had happened, they were not up to the mark and they were not able to have a temperature and they were not being validated as to the best of its performance. So taking this into consideration, this validation has to go on, and after the validation, the approval will be given by the DAC. So why is that we need to have is this, because with respect to the, and you should also know, the earlier deal was being cancelled in January because they could not meet up towards the indigenous man, was being not met because of the trials which was not been done perfectly. But they also felt that the requirement can be met with respect to the DRDO, which has been developing an indigenous manned portable missile. So this was one of the area where India compromised by not taking it from Israel, and they also cancelled the deal. But right now it is where the army has been facing a huge shortage of the anti-tank guided missiles, and they have to develop within the deadlines to what it has to be procured of. So that's the reason it is going through the government-to-government route right now. And earlierly the deal was nearly like $500 million, which respected, which has been accepted in accordance of the acceptance of necessities by the DAC in 2009. And this was been approved in 2014, but the contract was dragged on with respect to the cost and also the technology transfer, because the cost was not up to the mark and the technology transfer was being still dealt on, having a contract negotiation between the Israel and India. But the deal for 8,000 plus missiles and 300 plus launchers along the technology transfer to be built in India. So there's something in where the technology transfer takes in stage out here. And here the Spike is a third generation fire and forget man portable missile which has been manufactured by Israel, and there are almost nearly 40,000 millions which has been required to equip the army's 382 infantry battalions and 44 merchandise regiments. So, and also they were talking about the indigenous low weight missile which was successfully flight tested twice by the DRDO. But irrespective of this, is a deal which has been happening with respect to the Israelis. But still, anyways, it has been looking out for the validation trials, and after that only the approval will be coming with respect to the DAC, that's a Defense Acquisition Council. The next one, WhatsApp appoints a grievance officers. So this was with respect to the pressure to what happening with respect to the fake messages. Now the WhatsApp as appointing a grievance officer for India, and he outlined the process for the users to flag the concern and also the complaints which has been surrounding on the fake news. So this was one of the important key demands to what India had put forth on the WhatsApp to curb the fake messages on limelight of it, which was being triggered on the mob killings, and also the Facebook owned company has also updated its website. So on this, now the WhatsApp tells that it also appointed a grievance officer to look on to what is happening with respect to mob links and areas which has been triggered with respect to the mob link. So your the update mentions that the user can make use of the mobile app, send a mail, or you can even write it to one of the designated person of USA who is Komal Lahiri in terms of writing. So once they have done it, then they will be taking the complaints further and the things can be sorted at the earliest as per the grievance officer. So this is about it. And next one, full service carriers face the crosswinds from budget headlines. So this with respect to the budget headlines, and this has been completely there in the news with quite some times to what's happening with the domestic aviation market, where here is the passenger who is a king, where he'll be trying to headlines with oof with respect to him and her giving a lowest ticket prices for the full service carriers, which they're trying to seek out the kind of promises of high level of the services would be given with a global connectivity, where they're increasing under the pressure to cut the cost so that only then they will be able to travel within the country to remain relevant. So this is with respect to low cost carriers which has been happening, and the hit to the domestic aviation market in Britain. So we have the Jet Airways. They have decided to dispense with a complimentary meal on board. So this is the single most distinguishing feature for the full service carrier in the country. But the Vistara, in the month of August, that actually introduced a basket of fare options where they can pay in extra for any additional services such as meal on board, additional baggage allowances, seat selections, as well as for the free rescheduling and also the cancellations. This is something where Vistara had bought it, but recently here Jet Airways also dispensed for the complimentary meal on board. So this is one of the important thing. And here, by introducing the light fares, both the airlines aim to attract the passengers where there is a swing who have been happening from one airline to another, where the fare difference is as low as 200 to 300. So this is a difference amount to what can be seen. So that's one important aspect. And here the competitor airfares have offered a low-cost carriers, which is new and modern planes. They can be in very aggressive expansion plan and wider domestic network and with a higher frequencies, which has been a better punctuality. And they're forecasting that this might be close to 30% to be called as a decline in the domestic market. That's one of the forecastings to what's been happening. And the main area, so yeah, the basic informations to what is that they're dropping and forecasting to happen, so you can just look onto it. But the main information is that to why is this such of kind of an uncompetitiveness in terms of cost and the problems happening with the passengers with the low is because of the oil prices, which is nearing 80 per instance, $80 per barrel, and a rupee, which is hovering like 72 and right now it's 73 versus the dollars, and a massive capacity induction by the Indian carriers and the aviation industry, which is fares profitability, which has been becoming a challenges. So these are the main criteria as to why we have been facing the challenge. And they are also telling that we might have a full year loss, while FCS could be loss up to 1.75 to 2 billion in financial year 2019. This is in comparison with the three leading LCCs, Indigo, SpiceJet and the GoAir, are better placed than the full service centers carriers. So this is about it. So just a basic information. So the entire has been given into this particular chatty diagram. So you can just look onto it and you can get the complete information to what has been in terms of a letter forms. The next one, closely monitoring the financial market, says the SEBI and the RBI. So this is with respect to the equity markets, where it's been completely volatile. And here the central bank and the capital markets regulator, they're talking about they have been having a very close market and they would be taking a necessary action the time it has been needed. So there's one of the informations. And they were also trying to say that there were the stock markets, they were seeing a wild swings with respect to the small banking financial company, which has been hampered down, and the DHFL, that is the Dewan Housing Finance Limited, they have lost 42% of the market's capitalization, which also had impacted the NBFC stocks. So here we have the SBI, the largest lender. They also stepped in early fears of concerned investors. But the SBI chairman in return, he says that they would be still continuing to lend to the NBFCs and they would not be bothering about to what is being wearing of the lending of the NBFCs. They have not been attributed and not been commented in written. And they were also calling it to be as a baseless rumors, because here the SBIC is in full support lending to the NBFCs in private and also the public sectors, which is within the regulatory frame policy framework, and will also continue to do without irrespective to any of the interventions happening in Britain. So this personally, this with respect to financial markets, where the RBI and SEBI tells that monitoring, and also there were important aspects to what the SBI had to make it as a statement with respect to lending to the non-banking financial companies. The next one, decoding the total expense ratio. So this with respect to in mutual funds, and you could have seen it's quite sometimes in the news with respect to the FPIs, the foreign portfolio investments. So here where the investors, they are called as an investor entrust, is their money with an investment manager, where they are managing the money with the smartness and also more efficiently. So for whatever the management has been happening, there would be a charges which has been taken in terms of cost for an investment. So here the official regulator of the mutual funds, he had put on certain rules to how much has a asset management company they can charge on the investor. So this investor is the one which becomes very important, because this charge has been levied on their investment and they can get a proper kind of an investment reduced by their figure. For example, how it goes is that here the fund would be charging 2% on the TRA, that what is what we are talking as in total expense ratio to be as 2%, and the fund produces a gross profit as 15%. So this is in a given year. So the investor would get 13% because 2% is going for a TER, that's a total expense ratio. So this is with respect to the gross profit, which would be minus by the TER. So this is one of the important aspects. But latestly, you saw that the SEBI across the board lowered the TER and said that the fund house can charge its investors with lowering this. And this is reduction to the larger funds and also the lower for the smaller funds. So larger and the smaller, they have been completely measured on how much money a fund manager has been managing on. So this reduction has been almost with 0.01 to 0.4%, and a very small funds, and also the SEBI actually increased the allowable expense ratio to be as very little, and the mutual fund investor, he could see the marginal reduction in the fee and for what is being paid in return to increase the returns that they were getting in the near future. They can increase the returns is what the SBI's total calculation is all about in lowering the TER on a total aspects. So here they have specified that expense ratio for the funds larger than the largest funds today, and this is one of the anticipation in the for market growth. So here this was one of the important aspect which was being accompanied with the foreign portfolio investments, and this is a clear information to what is being called as an total expense ratio. So just go through them twice, you will understand what is that in detail. So this is about it. And question for the day, you have to list on to the varieties of hornbills and what is a paid due, 24-9-2018. Thank you.